tempts us in so many ways, doesn't he? I'm tempted to tell you, if we run over today, it's Tara's fault.
That was a good story.
I had it all planned out today. But the devil may be doing, I don't know if any of you remember Flip Wilson or not.
Yeah.
Flip Wilson was really popular back in the early 70s. And he was, you know, it just goes to show you somebody can be really, really funny and not have to use a lot of profanity or a lot of things that they're using in today's world to try to catch our attention. But the devil made me do it. I mean, that's an excuse that's been around since the beginning of sin, right?
Yes.
I mean, isn't that the same thing that Eve said when God caught up with her in the Garden of Eden? Said, what?
She said, the devil made me do it. I was just walking along. I put the devil whispering in my ear. And I didn't want to talk to him. I just pretended like he wasn't there. But he jumped in front of me. He did.
He just kept tempting me with that apple. And then all of a sudden, just threw it to me. I caught it. I didn't mean to. I just caught it. It was in my hand. He wouldn't leave me alone, so I just took one to get him out of my way. The devil made me do it. Now, you got to admit it. Her excuse was a lot better than Adam's. Because Adam blamed her, and then he blamed God for giving him her. Which, those of us in America, maybe we've done that. I blame God for giving him, for giving her, to me. Oh, I'm sorry. And temptation comes in many forms, in many ways, many times a day. Because I'm right now about tempted to throw that computer out the window, and I don't want to do that. So anyway, we know that the excuse, the devil made me do it, has been around for a long time. A lot of us have used it ourselves. But you may say the devil made me do it, but you need to understand that the devil can never make you do anything. You know, according to these ancient scriptures, the devil does have the power to to tempt us, to manipulate us, to deceive us. He has that power, but he can't make us do anything. He can't force you to say anything. But you have to understand, he is a strong adversary. He will come after you, and he will keep coming after you. He's strong, and this is what people think. This is why we said last week that when we're tempted, it is not really a temptation of our self-control. It's not really a temptation of our discipline. It's a temptation of our faith. Because you can't beat the devil in your own power. It's an impossibility. He is stronger than you are. He has been around for longer than you have. He has more experience than you have. So you can't beat the devil on your own. And that's why you have to rely on somebody who's defeated him in the past. And there's only one person that's ever defeated Satan in the past, and that is Jesus Christ. You have to rely on the power of the Holy Spirit through Jesus Christ if you want to beat the devil. So you know, if we've been here the last couple of weeks, that we've been studying this temptation, and particularly the temptation of Jesus in the desert where he defeats Satan, defeats the devil. And if you have Christ in you, I want you to know, the battle's already won. Jesus is already defeated. Now, in the desert, it says that the devil flee for a time, but he came back after. We know he came back after Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. We know he came back after Jesus several times. You can resist the devil, and he has to flee, according to the brother of Jesus, James, but he will come back to you. But Jesus defeated him when he died on the cross, and he rose and was resurrected. Satan was defeated. And if you have Christ in you, that means you have somebody in you that's stronger. Satan was a created being. God has been and always been. He's been around longer. He has more power. And you have that power available to you if you just will believe it. If you just by faith know in your mind that you have the power to overcome temptation. Now, if you missed any of those messages, you know, I would ask you to go to theodysseychurch.com or to our YouTube channel or download our app and watch them there. Not because the great speaker that's giving them, obviously, but because the messages are so important. Because whether you believe in Jesus or not, whether you believe Jesus is who he says he is or not, temptation is something we all face. And we face it many times a day in many different ways. So I challenge you, even if you're not a Christian, to go back and watch these things, or if you're thinking about becoming a Christian, to watch them, because temptation is something we're all going to face. And we face it all the time, don't we? And for many of us, the word temptation means different things. What's temptation to you may not be temptation to me. You know, for some people, you know, temptation is being, I can't control my tongue. For other people, I can't control my addictions. I can't quit drinking. For other parts, the temptation may be, you know, for promiscuity. For others of us, you know, maybe it's to spend too much money. You know, maybe you were like me. You know, I had them all at the same time. You know, I had temptation to drink. When I drank too much, I thought I was Casanova. When I thought I was Casanova, I'd spend more money on things like drinks. Many of us face more than one temptation at a time, don't we? And that's why these lessons are so important. Because we're all tempted in many ways and in really many ways at a time. Eat the apple or don't eat the apple? It's a question we get all the time. Every day. Many different forms. And what's an apple for you may not be an apple for me. We all have these selfish desires. We all make these unwise decisions. And what's a temptation to you may not be a temptation to me, because quite frankly, if it's not a temptation, we wouldn't give into the sin, would we? So the question I want you to think about this morning, the question that maybe I even want you to struggle with this morning, is what in the world do I want? What in the world do you want that you're set up to trade what's important for the immediate? What in the world do you want so badly, and it might even be a good thing, it might even be the reason that you know God created you. What is the thing that you want, but you're willing to do something you know isn't right to get the right thing in the wrong way? What is it you want that you're willing to compromise what you know is right, to compromise your values, maybe to justify what you know isn't just to get this thing that you lust? Whatever it is you struggle with, I just want you to know that you're not alone, you know? If we're all honest, if we're really honest with each other, all of us are tempted to do and say things that we know we shouldn't say and do. We are all tempted to do things that goes against our conscience, our mind, our belief system. And for me, you know, I don't know about you, but for me, I struggle in many areas of my life with this. You know, right now there's some things that I really want, and I have the ability to get them, but it would be an unwise decision. It would put me in debt. It would spend money that needs to go elsewhere. It would take money that I don't really have. But that temptation is always there because I like the newest, better things. But when we give in to temptation, the temptation itself is not a sin, but when we give in to the temptation, that becomes sin. So I want you to know right off the bat that if you're having a tough time making the right choices, that you're not alone. We all have a difficult time making the right choices. Temptation is simply defined as the enticement to commit an unwise or an immoral act, especially for a promised or perceived reward. When you think about it, what temptation is doing is saying, I'll give you this now if you'll just do this now. You know, I'll give you peace and quiet. I'll give you peace of mind if you'll just overindulge in alcohol. I'll fulfill that need that you're looking for, that immediate gratification, if you'll buy it now. I'll let you step out of your marriage and satisfy your lust if you do it now. It's always something that's enticing us to do what we know is wrong, because we're going to get a promised or perceived reward. So we feel this tension about what we know we should do, or sometimes what we know we shouldn't do. Should I eat the apple or shouldn't I eat the apple? And like the definition of temptation reminds us, sometimes it's just simply an unwise decision. It may not necessarily be sin. It's just an unwise decision. And you have to understand there's an actual war that's going on inside of you. There's an actual war that's going on inside of each one of it. And as we saw last week, it might even be a legitimate need. You know, Jesus was hungry. He had been fasting for 40 days. He was malnutritious. He'd been in the desert. He was hot. There was a legitimate need. He needed nourishment. He needed food. Jesus is in the desert. He's been tempted day in and day out. We forget that sometimes. We just think that he's been tempted at the last. But he was tempted day in and day out for 40 days. But like many of you know, when you're at your weakest is when Satan turns up the heat the highest. And the temptation was not that fill this legitimate need, but to fill it in an illegitimate way, an improper way, an unwise way. So first of all, you have to know that at least three things are going to happen when you give in to temptation. When you give in to sin, at least three things happen. First of all, you are stealing from your future and probably from the future of those we love. Probably the ones that we love the most. We're replacing the important with the immediate. We're telling God we don't trust Him. Tara, can you change that slide, please? Now, if you're not a Christian, you may not even be concerned about this last one. You know, if you're not a Christian, you're not concerned about whether you're telling God you don't trust Him. You don't even believe in Him. But I hope and pray one day you will. You know, we're all born sinful. And since we're all born sinful, we have this deep-seated desire to live our life on our own way, in our own terms, instead of living like God's way and on His terms. I mean, the struggle is real and the appeal is real. It's not imaginary. We feel the tension and the power of the struggle and temptation. You don't have to teach a child to lie, do you? 2-year-old will lie to you. You don't have to teach a child to be selfish with their toys. That's mine. You don't have to teach a 2-year-old to be manipulative. You don't have to teach them to hide when they're in trouble. And that comes natural to them. Now, if you don't believe that, it just means you don't have any kids. Because I'm telling you, I got 4 of them. Some of them still like it, the 2-year-olds. You have to teach them not to do those things, because in our natural habitat, in our natural minds, in our sinful nature, all that stuff comes natural. And sometimes we just have to go back to the beginning and know and stop and pause and think about what's going to happen if we give in to temptation. And most often we're in the middle of temptation before we even realize it. So if we would pause, if we would stop beforehand and remember that we're actually stealing from your future. If I buy that thing, you know, I've got to pay interest on it. It's going to cost me twice as much. It's going to take the money that I don't have. I wouldn't have to put it on credit if I had the cash in the bank. We're replacing what's important with the immediate. And really, in all sincerity, what we're doing is we're just telling God, I can provide for me better than you can provide for me. I know you got me this far, God, but I got it from here. I'll take care of it now. I don't trust you to give me more in the future than I can get for myself right now. And I look at this, and I'm all week long, I've had all kinds of temptations. And if I'm honest, there's probably a few that I actually gave into. Now, why do we keep giving in temptation? And for most of it, maybe you're different than me, the temptation I have the most is the one that I had before. It's not like the devil throws something new at me. I still have the same temptations that I had 10 years ago sometimes. They're not as strong. I don't do them. But the temptations seem to repeat themselves. Why do I keep making bad decisions? The same bad decisions over and over sometimes. And I think it's because just in that moment, we just haven't stopped, we haven't paused, we haven't taken the time to think about the fact that we're actually stealing from the future. That what's right in front of us is not, the temptation that's in front of us is not the real problem. It is not what is at stake. It's not the thing that's right in front of us. There's something much greater at stake. You know, some of my greatest regrets in life started like this. I know I shouldn't do this, but I know I should. I mean, some of the greatest, I had the opportunity yesterday to speak at a friend of mine's father's funeral. I'd known him for like 40 years. And I'm talking to him on the phone, and we're reminiscing when we were teenagers and in our early 20s. And he said, "Rob, I don't mind you mentioning anything, just don't mention that one thing." And I said, "Brother, you got to be just a little bit more clarified than that, okay? Because when me and you were together, there was a lot of things. You know, why did I keep making the same wrong decisions? The same decisions that today, even years later, some of them I'm still paying for. Some of them, the decisions I made when I was in business, decisions I made before I got married, the decisions I made with my finances, the people I love most, like my wife and my kids, they're still paying a penalty for. And in the moment, I never thought about the future. It was about what was immediate. What is the pleasure that I can get right now? And the thought of telling God that I didn't trust Him didn't even cross my mind. It's not that I didn't believe in God. It just wasn't part of my thinking. And that's why this is so important to me. You know, I know I shouldn't do it, but, you know, maybe just this one time. And one of the things I've learned is it's if you just know what not to do or what to do, it becomes pretty difficult. I mean, I can sit up here all day long and tell you not to give in to temptation and why not to give it into temptation, and the application just doesn't sink in sometimes. And it's not the knowing, the knowledge that will keep you from sin, it's the application that keeps you from sin. Now, a lot of you know that I've been having to go to physical therapy for my arm. I've got a torn muscle in my shoulder, and it's not going to be able to be repaired. So the idea is to get, there's four muscles that hold your shoulder on, is for the other three to get strong enough so I have better mobility in my arm. And I've had some really great physical therapists, and they tell me what to do. And I take the information they give me, and I do it because they got more experience, they got more medical knowledge, they know what they're doing. But it wasn't until I got a physical therapist that would come along and he would actually touch the muscle in the back. He goes, I want you to work that muscle. And here's why I want you to work that muscle. That muscle right there is going to help you lift your arm higher. It'll help compensate for the other muscle. Before, I was just doing the exercises because the guy told me to do the exercises. But once I understood why I was doing the exercises and what behind the exercises,
amen,
now it started to make sense.
Amen.
So that's what I want you to learn out of this. This is why this is so important. Just to sit up here and tell you what not to do, you're never going to do it. People have told me what not to do all my life, and I just keep on doing it. And when you know the what and the why, then you can start having the application, and the application will produce transformation. Now, James, the brother of Jesus, tells us how the devil begins this dirty deed of temptation. And James writes to Christians who are really out in the wilderness. He begins his letter by telling to those who are in tribulation. The Christians had been dispersed because of tribulation. They were actually running away. They were in fear of their lives. And James is writing them to give them comfort and tell them what's going on and show them that there's this power in God and there's this confidence in God. You probably heard the same before, you know, have joy in all the tribulation. And James is not saying, hey, when you're tempted, when you have tribulation, when you're having what, you are being tempted, go through the tribulation with joy because you're keeping your eye on something bigger. That this tribulation, this testing that the Lord is allowing you to go through is going to form you into the very image of God the Son, Jesus Christ. And if you keep your eyes on that, you can go through the tribulation, which is not joyful, but you can have joy in the tribulation because you're looking at a bigger picture. So they're in the wilderness. They're experiencing all kinds of temptations, all kinds of testing, all kinds of trial, all kinds of a test because of their faith. In chapter 1, verse 13 of his letter, James makes it clear where the temptation does not come from. He says, and remember, when you're being tempted, do not say, God is tempting me. God is never tempted to do wrong, and he never tempts anyone to do wrong. He never tempts anyone else. So when you're being and you're facing temptation, it may be God who sent you in the wilderness to be tempted, but he is not the one tempting you. We can't blame it on God when we're tempted. But here's the thing. If you're in the wilderness and you're facing temptation, it just simply means that God loved you as much as he loves his son, Jesus Christ. He sent his son to be tempted. He sent his son to go and be and face temptation. Sometimes he does this so that we can build character. So we can learn perseverance. God allows these temptations, this testing, so that we can flex our spiritual muscles and develop them so that we can have success in the future. Sometimes he allows these temptations in our lives. I know so many people that have come to God simply because of the test and the temptation. God sometimes allows us to draw us closer to him because he loves us, not because he's mad at us, not because we've done something wrong, but because he loves us so very much. And he wants us to learn the lesson that no matter what the difficulty, he can be trusted.
So true.
God is never tempted to do wrong, and he never tempts anyone. So why do we fall for the devil's tricks so often? I mean, why do we keep falling in to the temptation and giving in to sin? And James tells us why, right away. Temptations comes from our own selfish desire, which entice us and drag us away. The devil will whisper something in your ear, something you already want. He puts our own desires, our own selfish desires, right between our ears. The mind is the beginning of sin. Temptation begins at our own time. Temptation begins even with our own desires. If we didn't desire it, it wouldn't tempt us. Simple as that. Hey, Mama. We didn't get to watch all of Flip Wilson, but you know. Hey, Mama, look at that dress in the window. What happens? He whispers his desires in our mind. We get a thought, and that thought begins to take root in our imagination. We begin to picture ourselves. We begin to see ourselves right in the middle of whatever sin, whatever desire is that we want. It begins to work on our imagination. And as our imagination begins to picture, it produces an emotion. Emotion and feelings are very, very strong. And the more we imagine it, the more we feel it, the more we see ourselves in the middle of it, whatever that temptation is, the more likely we're going to do it. Our imagination turns into emotion. Emotions are strong. Feelings have power, and they entice us. And if we let them take root, they will drag us away. Every single good idea, every single bad idea begins right between your ears. They begin in your mind with our own desires, and most of us, we just don't take the time, we don't pause, we don't even think about it until it's too late. So when we're tempted, the first thing to do is just stop. Pause for a moment. And remember, what's at stake isn't what's right in front of you. What's at stake is much greater than the temptation that's right in front of your nose. What's at stake is our future, and more than likely, the future of the people that we love. You know, the first week, I gave you the example of my dad. You know, the temptation to smoke overwhelmed him. He was a heavy smoker. She died at 62 of lung cancer. What's at stake is more than our self-discipline. What's at stake is that we want to replace what's important with what's immediate. We want the gratification now instead of the satisfaction later. And we're really, you know, what's at stake is our faith in God. And this is really important. You're telling God, God, I think I'm going to do a better job of providing for me than you are going to do providing for me. Now, Jesus is teaching in the crowd one day, and a guy walks up to him and says, you know, teacher, what's the greatest commandment? Now, if you think about it, that's really a great question, right? I mean, I've got all these rules and these regulations, all these laws, and there is no way I'm going to be able to keep them all, but maybe if you just give me one. Maybe if you give me the most important one, I'll keep that. Can't keep them all, but I'll keep this one. So Jesus says, you know, the greatest commandment is to love God. And he says the second is just like it, and that is to love others. Love God and love others. All the sayings of the prophets, everything in the Old Testament, everything I've ever said, everything God ever said will fall into place if you just love God and you love others. One of the members of our church gave me this great book the other day called The Greatest Thing in the World by Henry Drummond. The foreword was written by a man named D.L. Moody. And you may not know D.L. Moody, but maybe you've heard of him, the Moody Bible Institute. Moody, maybe you read a book by him, Moody Publishing, Moody World Global Ministries. Maybe you've heard a sermon by D.L. Moody. But D.L. Moody actually wrote the foreword in this book. And D.L. Moody, he said, the one great need in our Christian life is love. More love to God and more love to each other. It would be that we would all move into that love chapter and live there. And when I read that, I said, that's perfect. That's the reason we sin. That's the reason we fall into temptation. That's the reason we give in to sin, because we're giving in to our selfish desire and letting them get rooted in our imagination. And when our selfish desires move into our imagination, we start to feel this emotion and we give into it. And what we're saying is, I love myself in this moment more than I love God and more than I love others. That's what we're saying when we fall into temptation. Your needs, your concerns, your way of life, what you want me to do is not as important as what I want to do in this very moment. And if we would all just fall into that love chapter and live there, half the temptations we have would just simply disappear. We picture ourselves in a sin. That sin produces an emotion. James tells us what will happen and where it's going to lead us. He says, these desires give birth to sinful actions. When we feel that emotion, if we let it take root, the more we begin to feel this strong desire, the more our imagination works on us, the more we get the notion, these desires give birth to sinful action, and when sin is allowed to grow, it gives birth to death. We start picturing ourselves in the very act of doing the very thing that we know is wrong, and our imagination brings forth this emotion, and that emotion, because emotions are strong, that emotion entices us, it drags us away, and these desires, if not stopped, pulled out like a weed, will give birth to sinful actions, and when sin is allowed to grow, it gives birth to sinful actions, and sinful actions lead to death, because what's at stake is more important than what's right in front of you. When we do this, what we're saying is, I love myself more than I love you, God. I love you. I love myself more than I love you. I want to do the things that I want to do, and I don't care about the things you want to do. It's really that simple. We don't think about it in the moment, but that's really what it is. And I think we all know this. It's just that in that moment of temptation, we don't stop. We don't pause. We don't think. We're in the middle of sin before we even realize it. And if we would just take the time to make our desires more important than God's desire. We're in the middle of sin, but if we would take the time to remember God's desires for us are more important than our desires and what's best for others, to love God and love others, we wouldn't give in to temptation half as much as we do now. We do what we're supposed to do and wouldn't do what we're not supposed to do. So last week, you know, like I said, we saw how the devil tempts us in our physical bodies. You know, we're all made up of mind or soul, whichever way you want to word, body and spirit. So God has given us an example of the three ways we can be tempted. Now we can be tempted in different ways, but they all affect either our mind, our spirit, or our body. And Jesus has been out in the wilderness without food for 40 days. He's been tempted every day, day in and day out, and Satan comes to him and says, listen, you're hungry. Provide food for yourself. You can do that. And we know later Jesus did it. I mean, he took three fish and a couple loaves of bread and fed 5,000 people with it. It says 5,000 men. There's probably closer to 20,000 people there. So Jesus could have done it, but when he did, he would be reaching into the future. And I mean, if Jesus had given to sin, there'd be no hope for us. He'd be replacing the important with the immediate. He'd be telling God, I don't trust you to provide me for me for food later. So now the devil comes along, and he gets Jesus to be tempted to fill a legitimate need in an illegitimate way. That doesn't work. So now Satan moves into a very powerful arrow, the demonic. I mean, really, every temptation begins here. Every good thought begins there too. What you get to choose your attitude. That's the good part about it. You get to choose, eat the apple or not the apple. It's your choice. And because we're all born in sin, we know we have this selfish desire. So look how the devil tempts Jesus in his mind. He says, the devil took him up and revealed to him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. Now we don't know how that is, whether you know they transported to Jerusalem, it says in a moment of time, but he shows him all the kingdoms of the world. And he said, I will give you the glory of these kingdoms and authority over them. And this is interesting. The devil said, because they are mine to give to anyone I please. And I'll give it all to you if you'll just worship me. See, I don't think that Satan really cares if you fall into temptation one time. He wants you to worship him. And every time you get into temptation, you're just a little bit closer to worshiping him than you are worshiping Jesus. So there Jesus, he's standing before all the kingdoms of the world. Now you got to think about this. This is the reason he came. This is the reason he was born a man as a child and grew up. He wants us, he's tempted by the king of tempters, to take a shortcut to get exactly what he came from. Jesus knows and the devil knows that the shortcut is going to be a lot less painful and a lot less time consuming. And this is so important. This is so important because somewhere, sometime in your life, it's probably already happened, maybe you haven't even thought about it, but at some point in time, if it hasn't happened, it will. There will be a time, probably many times in your life, when you will be presented with an opportunity to get exactly what you want, maybe even exactly what you believe you were created for, but to get it, you have to take a shortcut. We all get opportunities in our life to jump ahead, to take a shortcut, to move closer to whatever goal it is that we have, whatever thing we're chasing, whatever that person is, that thing is. The only catch is we have to lay down, at least temporarily, we have to lay down, we have to abandon our values. And the thing is, it may even be a good thing. It may even be the right thing, but the temptation is to get the right thing in the wrong way. To take a shortcut, to set aside our morals, to put down our values, to lay aside what we know is right, take our eyes off of God, and bypass all the hard work and time it would take to get this promotion, or get this progression, or get this person, or get this thing, get this possession. We have to lay everything that we know is right aside. And it may even be the right thing, but the temptation is to get it the wrong way. You know, I really like some of the benefits of marriage, especially that intimacy part. But I'm going to skip right over the wedding and head straight to the honeymoon. I'll go out Saturday night and I'll sow my seeds, and I'll go to church Sunday morning and I'll pray for cocktail. I'll lay down my morals just this one time so I can close this deal. You know, if you want to get ahead in this company, there's no way you can do it and live by the ways of God. If you want to get ahead in this company, you got to play by their rules. And their rules don't exactly go along. I mean, I'm just bending them a little bit. I mean, I know what God says. It's not really breaking. It's just bending. Once I do this job, once I get this promotion, once I get this bonus, I'll start doing the right thing. I'm just going to temporarily, just for a few moments, just for a few weeks, I'm going to lay down aside what I know is right. You know, I know it's not right to cheat on my exams. I know that's not right. But you know, I'm behind, and if this guy gives me the answers and I cheat, I'm going to graduate on time. I can even probably, you know, start my career and start giving more to the church. And besides, who uses trigonometry in the real world, you know? I need that job. I need that job. And I know I can't afford that car right now, but you know, they're the ones willing to give it to me. You know, I feel better about myself. I won't be so embarrassed when I go on the interview. I know I can get a cheap one I can afford, but that one's the one that's going to make me feel good. I'll figure out a way, some kind of way to make the payments. You know, I just can't wait 2 more years to get that thing I want. I know I'm running up my credit cards, and I don't have any emergency funds, but what's a couple $100 when you're so far in debt already? That reminds me of this boy. You know, he'd been trying to save up for a bicycle for a long time, but every time he'd get close to having money, he'd spend it. You know, temptation was, you know, I got this money and I want this thing. I'll get this now, I'll save up again later. And the boy, you know, his mom started taking him to church, and he heard a message on prayer, so he began praying for this bicycle. He said, "Lord, give it to me." But then the pastor started talking about how he had to do something. He had to have self-discipline. He couldn't give in to temptation. The boy says, "You know, I don't know if I like that." But the next week, the pastor starts preaching on God's grace and God's mercy and God's forgiveness. The boy liked that, so he just goes out and steals a bike and asks God to forgive him. Took a shortcut. Isn't that what we do? I mean, that may be an extreme story, but isn't that what we do? We take a shortcut to get what we want because we don't have the self-discipline. We don't have the trust in God to provide more for us later than we can get on our own right now. It's not the temptation that's the sin. It's the thing we desire may not be the sin. It's when we give into it and we try to get this thing, even the right thing, in the wrong way. Now, some of it is sin. If you're desiring another man's wife or another man's husband, that's sin. If you're coveting something that somebody else has, that's sin. If you're tempted to go against God's word, that's sin. But some things are legitimate needs, and Satan wants us to fulfill them in an illegitimate, improper, unwise way, irresponsible way. And the temptation of the mind is to take a shortcut to get what you want. Lay aside your values. Put down your ethics. Put up your convictions and values. To get what you haven't earned is a temptation for each one of us. That's why, you know, truthfully, salespeople have such a terrible reputation. Because some of them, not all of them, are willing to do whatever it is to get the deal. They'll put aside all their ethics, what they know is right, just to get the deal. And in his humanness, Jesus was tempted. But I don't think there was ever a temptation to give in to sin, because he knew exactly who he was and whose he belonged to. all the kingdoms, you know, Satan's standing right there, and he says, all the kingdoms, everything you came for, all the people that you created are right here, and I will give them all to you, because they're mine to give to you right now. All you have to do is just lay down what God the Father has told you to do, and you worship me. Now, it's not forever. It's just in a moment of time. And this is what Satan does. He blinds us. He says, you know, you're in the middle of the desert. Ain't nobody going to know but me and you. No pain, no torture, no beatings, no cross, no breaking your mama's heart, no death. You just bypass all that, and you can have it all right now. And Jesus, you know it's your Father's will anyway. So why go through all the mess? Just get it right now. All you have to do is submit to me and worship me this one time, temporarily. Give into my authority, and I'll give it all to you. And this is so powerful, because notice what Jesus does. He says, he doesn't say, you don't have the authority to do that, Satan. He doesn't say, it's not yours to give, Satan. He says, Satan says, I will give you the glory of these kingdoms and authority over them, because they are mine to give, and anyone I please, and I will give it all to you if you just worship me. And Jesus doesn't argue with him, and he doesn't correct him.
That's right.
So let me give you just a little extra Bible teaching this morning so we can make sense of that. I mean, because that was really confusing when I was a young Christian. And the Bible calls him more than one place. Satan is the ruler of this world. Satan is the prince of this world. I'm like, what happened? God created Adam and Eve. He said, you will reign over all the fish in the sea, the birds in the sky, the livestock, all the wild animals that are, and the small animals that stray along the ground. God says, man, you have authority over the earth and everything in it and everything on it. You even have authority over the air. Everything was under the authority of man.
That's right.
But when man and woman shifted their allegiance from God to themselves, to himself and herself, guess what with man and woman? Their authority. That's one of the reasons God the Son came to dwell among the people. He came to live a sinless life, which we're incapable of living, to reclaim the authority over heaven and earth. Now, if you don't know much about the Bible, you're not a Christian, you may not know the last chapter in the Gospel of Matthew, what we call the Great Commission. He's been given all authority over heaven and on earth. Jesus reclaimed the authority that me and you, that Adam and Eve lost and couldn't reclaim because of all our sin. All the authority in heaven and earth went with us when we sinned. Jesus came back, he reclaimed it. And the good news is, when you make Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior, when you invite Jesus in your heart and you surrender his will or your will to his will, you're no longer under the devil's rule. The Apostle Paul said, for he has rescued us from the kingdom of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his dear Son.
Hallelujah.
We are now in Christ. Christ is in us. And we have authority over heaven and earth once again. We have reclaimed our authority, not in our strength, but in and through God the Father, by the blood of Jesus Christ, God the Son, and the power of the Holy Spirit. What we were willing to give away in our giving into temptation, our sinful action, God sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to reclaim for us. And if we have him, he is in us. And through Jesus Christ, we have that same authority that Adam and Eve had in the beginning.
Amen. It is so.
Look how Jesus answered them. Jesus replied, the scriptures say, you must not worship the Lord your God, or you must worship the Lord your God and serve him only. And again, Jesus reaches back in the book of Deuteronomy, and he remembers, he reaches back into the past, and he remembers God's faithfulness, and quotes God's words and God's commands. If you want to fight Satan, if you want to fight the devil, if you want to fight temptation, you have to have God's word stored in your heart. You're only going to serve God and worship God if you know God. And the only way to know God's word is to study God's word. Confidence in Scripture will lead to confidence in temptation.
Amen.
Confidence in Scripture will lead to confidence in temptation. If you're going to fight a battle, you better have the right tools. You don't go against an army with tanks with a bow and arrow. You got to fight with the right weapons, and the Word of God calls the Word of God a sword. The author of the book of Hebrews puts it this way, for the Word of God is alive and powerful. It's sharper than the sharpest two-edged sword, cutting between soul and spirit, between joint and marrow. It exposes our innermost thoughts and desires. other words, when you read scripture, you begin to see what's really in your heart. Those selfish desires. The Word of God exposes the temptations that come from our own selfish desires. The selfish desires which entice us and drag us away. The selfish desires which give birth to sinful actions. And sinful actions will always lead to death. Our selfish desires come from our thoughts. Our thoughts give way to our imagination. We begin to imagine what it would look like to have that thing or that person. Our imagination begins to create emotions, and emotions are strong and they're powerful, and they can lead us from the thought of temptation to the act of sinful action. And this is important to know, because you just can't wait for temptation to show up. You have to decide in advance. You have to make up your minds now. You have to prepare, because in the moment of temptation, you're going to find out who you are and whose you belong to.
Amen.
Who you are and whose you are. In that moment of temptation, you find that out. And you won't remember you're a child of God and belong to the kingdom of God in the heat of the moment, in the temptation, if you don't decide that in advance. You must decide before the tempter comes, before the temptation comes, that you are a child of God and you belong to God and the kingdom of God. Confidence in scripture will lead to confidence in temptation. But you can't stay strong if you don't know the Word of God and you don't know the promises of God. Plan in advance for the attack. You'll not only win the battle, you'll win the war. Really, the fact is, it's already been won for you. Jesus Christ, at his death and resurrection, won the battle for us. He's already won the victory over temptation. So we have to do our part and believe by faith the promises of God. You can't know and you can't believe the promises of God if you've never read the promises of God. God has a plan and a purpose for your life. Plans for good and not for disaster, to give you a future and a hope. And you don't have to break the rules, and you don't have to bend the law. You don't have to give in to your morals. You don't have to take shortcuts to fulfill God's plans for your life. The temptation is to reach out into the future and steal from it. We get involved with people that we shouldn't get involved with, and we know we shouldn't get involved with, and we stay longer than we should, and we're stealing from our future because we're in this mess. And if we just never got there in the first place, we wouldn't have it. And if we would learn to think what it's costing us, we'd get out of it. Now, I don't mean divorce, because if you're married, you already made your bed, now you got to make it how to work. But if you're not married, get out of the mess. If you're so far in debt you can't see straight, don't go in debt anymore. If the temptation is to buy more at the store than you're afford, don't go to the store. You know, when I quit drinking years ago, I knew I couldn't go to places they served alcohol. The temptation was too strong. So I didn't go. I didn't put myself in that. Don't put yourself in the position. The temptation is to reach in your future and to steal from, to reach out in the future of others, particularly the people you love, and steal from their future and place the important with the immediate. And when we do, we're just simply telling God and telling others, I love me more than I love you. I don't trust you to provide for me for more in the future than I can get for myself right now in the present. And in that moment of temptation, you're going to discover who you are and who you are. And if you don't prepare beforehand, chances are you're going to bow down and you're going to give in to sin. And you're going to give in to your selfish desires. And they'll entice you and drag you away and give birth to sinful action, which will lead to death. It may not be a physical death right away. Maybe it's the death of a marriage. Maybe it's the death to your good health. Maybe it's the death of your reputation. Maybe it's the death of your integrity. Maybe it's the death of your finances. Sinful actions will always lead to some kind of death, because you can't accomplish the will of God by abandoning the principles of God.
Amen.
You'll never accomplish the blessings of God by abandoning the values of God. And when you lay aside your morals, when you compromise your conscience, when you take shortcuts, when you step out of God's will, even if it's for a moment, even if it's temporarily, even this one time, even for a while, you risk missing God's intervention. You risk seeing what God will do on your behalf. If you just trusted Him, if you break and you bend the rules, if you bow, you'll never know what God may have done on your behalf if you had just trusted Him for a little bit longer to give you more in the future than you can get for yourself right now. You'll never know that if you give in to temptation. and take it for yourself and don't wait on God.
Amen.
Every temptation is more than a test of your self-control. Every temptation is more than a test of your self-discipline. It's a test of your faith in the living God. Don't steal from your future and the future of the people you love. Don't replace what's important with the immediate, because if you do, you'll never know what God may have done that's so much greater than what you have done. And here's one more truth. And you know it to be true. Sin is like an appetite. The more you feed it, the larger it gets. And once you get a taste of it, it is so much easier to do it the next time. Once you get a taste of that sin, a taste of that temptation, it's so much easier to bow down the next time. And then all of a sudden, that one-time thing becomes an all-the-time thing. Nobody ever plans to become an alcoholic or a drug addict or an adulterer or a thief. They bow down one time and then the next time. I had a friend of mine that was in business, and he had a habit of ignoring the IRS. He would say, I was like an ostrich, I'd stick my head in the sand. And all of a sudden, the IRS come down and closed everything he had, and a lot of things were exposed in that moment. He said, you know, I was married, my secretary was my girlfriend. He goes, and the first time I ever cheated on my wife, he goes, I was scared to death. We went to the darkest, the most faraway places, everything we could. She knew it was wrong, I almost knew it was wrong. We knew we shouldn't do it, but. And he said, you know what, before I knew it, I was going on vacation. I took my girlfriend with me. I'd take my secretary with me, and she would be in the hotel room next to where my wife was sleeping. And when my wife went to the store or the beach, guess where I was? He said, what started out that was so difficult? He goes, over the course of time, it became so easy, I didn't even think about it. Sin is like an appetite. You feed it, it'll grow. And each time you do it, it becomes easier and easier. And when you do, Satan doesn't really care if you give it a temptation one time. It's not the temptation to give it into sin that he's worried about. What he wants you to do is to bow down and worship him. And you keep on doing it. You'll do it without even realizing you're doing it. What I want to ask you this morning, what in the world do you want? What is the thing? What is the person? What is the possession? What is the promotion? What is the progress you want so bad? It might not even be a bad thing. It might even be something that you believe and God believes and you were created to do, but you're tempted to take a shortcut to get. What is that thing inside of you? What is your desire, the thing, the person you want so strongly that you're tempted to lay aside, not forever, but just for a little while, just for a moment, you're going to lay aside what you know is right in order to get whatever it is you want. What is it or who is it that you desire to have that you're willing to compromise, break the rules, bend the law, go against, justify? What is not just, so that you can have it. What in the world do you want? Are you willing to trust God to give it to you? Because when you take a shortcut, you miss out on the opportunity to experience God's intervention on your behalf. So to overcome temptation, you must plan in advance. Because more than likely, the odds are against you if you don't plan and prepare. In the heat of the moment, in the midst of temptation, if you aren't grounded in your faith, and your trust in God is not firm, it's likely that you'll give in to your selfish desire and they'll entice you and drag you away, and they'll give birth to sinful actions. The best way to repair is to have confidence in the Scriptures, because when you have confidence in the Scriptures, you'll have confidence in the temptation. For the Word of God is alive and powerful and sharper than the sharpest two-edged sword, cutting between soul and spirit, between joint and marrow, and exposes our innermost thoughts. I've been told the great evangelist Billy Graham had handwritten in the front of his Bible, either by himself or by somebody else in his personal Bible, he had written, either sin will keep you from the Bible or the Bible will keep you from sin. Confidence in Scripture will give you confidence in temptation. And finally, you must know who you are and whose you are. You should repeat this out loud every day. I've started doing it, and I'm, you know what the amazing thing is without even realizing it? It's changed my attitude.
Yes.
Okay? Repeat this over and over again. I am a child of God, and I have been adopted by God, and I belong to God's family.
Amen.
I have Jesus as a big brother, and I'm going to inherit the kingdom of God.
Amen.
I am a child of God. I have been adopted by God, and I belong to God's family. And Jesus is my big brother, and I will inherit the kingdom of God. because it's important. Because in that moment of temptation, you're going to discover who you are and whose you are. And if you don't prepare in advance, if you don't have confidence in Scripture, it won't be until the temptation comes that you truly know who you are and whose you are. And in that moment, if you're not prepared and you don't have confidence in Scripture so you can have confidence in temptation, your selfish desires will entice you and drag you away and give birth to sinful actions, and that will lead you to death. Maybe not immediate physical death, but the death of something will occur, because death always occurs when we give in to sin. So if you will you stand with me? And let's close this service as we've done for the past 2 weeks by repeating this reminder of the dangers of temptation and giving in to sin. Now maybe you all are stronger than I am, but I just want to be as safe, and I want to assume that everyone's as weak as I am. And I want this to be so embedded in my body, in my mind, in my spirit, that when temptation comes, that I'm going to stop, I'm going to pause, and I'm going to remember this so I do not give in to temptation. So my temptation does not lead me into sinful action. I want to model my Lord and Savior, not bow down to temptation and give in to sin. So let's repeat this together. I feel the frustration of temptation, but temptation, you will not steal my future. You will not steal my faith. You will not steal my joy, because I will not give in to sin. We'll do it one more time?
Yeah.
I feel the frustration of temptation. But temptation, you will not steal my future. You will not steal my faith. You will not steal my joy, because I will not give in to sin. Let me pray for you. Heavenly Father, we thank you. I thank you for the people that are here today. Father, I know that you love each one of them. And Lord, I know sometimes you send us into the wilderness areas. But Lord, it's always with a purpose, to build our character, to strengthen us, to flex our spiritual muscles so that when a larger temptation comes, we'll be able to overcome. Father, let us stop. Let us think. Let us remember that whatever the temptation is, there's more at stake than what's in front of us. And if we allow it to be embedded in our emotion, and if it starts to get in our imagination and we start to have these feelings, we picture ourselves in it, that it's just going to lead us into the wrong place. It's going to lead us into sinful action. So, Father, help us to stop. Help us to pause. Help us to remember how much you love us, that you sent your one and only Son to die so that we could spend all eternity for you. And may we model Jesus, the Son of God, God himself, by withstanding the temptation of the devil. I ask this in the precious name of your Son, our Savior, our Lord, Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Amen.
All right, we'll ask you all to come back next week as we finish up this series. And in my opinion, this may be the most important lesson of all, because we're going to be talking about the temptation of the spirit, and eternity is too long to be wrong. So may the power of the Holy Spirit go with you, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Spirit be with you.